Mr. Pandey, you know, we are at the moment, you know, to speak of the current issue, we could be in the throes of higher tariffs coming from the United States, or at least started to come from the United States. Do you think the response of India also would be to raise tariffs in competition so that we don't face the brunt of cheap goods getting rushed in? What do you think would be or should be the Indian response in case of higher tariffs from the United States?
Well, I think this higher tariffs and, you know, the potential higher tariffs as well as the geo-economic fragmentation are somehow the facts of life post-COVID, post-Ukraine crisis, and going forward supply chain disruptions which are going to be there. Well, technically, you know, any high tariff protectionism would really depress overall world growth. And if you have a depression in world trade growth, obviously everyone will be less better off, all the trading partners. So that is a conventional wisdom. And I think if you really look at previous record of protectionism following the Great Depression,
yes,
and we had one of the, you know, it's everyone, I mean, Pauper my neighbor, I mean, that doesn't really work. I think Prosper we together really works together. But then, given the realities, one need to really understand how differentially people will understand how the RTAs, regional trading arrangements, and the free trade agreements will work out within certain groupings. There would be trade diversions. So we are really moving away from classical trade theory. And we are really looking into a pragmatic world where, you know, a lot will depend upon how the things will be rolled out. And every country will actually look at their own interest, including India.
Yeah, I mean, we have to wait for what happens out of the United States, and we will know that after January 20th. Yes, Krishna, you want to say something?
So I don't think we should wait for what the US does. I think we have an issue here where I think India needs to liberalize its trade. You know, the Secretary mentioned the fact that we have a young population. The young population also needs jobs, right? So we have to create jobs, and that there are two things there. One, we have to implement the labor codes, which is important, to make the labor market more flexible. And we also have to liberalize trade so that firms can compete well in the market. Otherwise, you know, India could get old without it becoming rich. So I think it's important that we liberalize trade. It was talked about this morning. The private sector also talked about it in the morning. Liberalize trade, allow firms to compete, allow greater, you know, flexibility in labor markets, and you generate jobs both in manufacturing and services. If you look at structural transformation in Asia, with the last 30 years, you compare just two countries, Vietnam and India. In the last 30 years, the share of manufacturing, labor share of manufacturing in Vietnam has quadrupled, right? In India, it's almost flat. So you need to create jobs. It's not that the manufacturing sector is not open. You can still create value added there and jobs there, but you have to have the kind of structural reforms which we need to embark upon to reach the goal of an advanced country. Otherwise, without these kind of reforms, you know, in terms of trade liberalization, labor flexibility, and continued work on infrastructure, just three to talk about, and then we'll talk about on skilling. If you want to really go up the frontier, you have to invest in education, not in terms of dollar amount, but in terms of how you skill your workforce. I think these are important structural reforms which have to be embarked upon right away to meet the aspirational goal of being an advanced country by 2047.
To be fair, the government has been on the skilling ball for quite some time now.
Yes.
There is a skilling body, and right now there's a very great experiment on asking private sector to use their CSR money, the corporate social responsibility money, to get interns and skill them.
That needs to continue and also continues to strengthen going forward.
Okay. If I could just ask August the same thing. Mm-hmm. If you looked at the, for instance, Vietnam as an example, mm-hmm. India is still, the aspiration is right that we want to have more money coming out of manufacturing, more GDP coming out of manufacturing, more jobs. What is it that's missing that we are not getting to, say, the Vietnam contribution to manufacturing?
So let me combine this question with the question on tariff, and to give a concrete example. tariffs are not good for growth. They're not good for the global economy. They're not good for the global community. In 2023, the global economy, global government around the world, introduced 3,000 anti-trade measures. That slowed down growth. If you look at growth from 2019 to 2023, the global growth has been going down. It has something to do with the fact that people are closing trade channels around the world. Then coming to Vietnam, India, and linking it to tariff, a good experiment is mobile phones. India and Vietnam have invested in mobile phone production to export it. You know, part of the China plus one, if you will. In 2010, Vietnam's share of global mobile phone export was 1%. India's share was also 1% of global export. By 2023, India's share more than doubled to 2.4%. Vietnam's shares went up by 13%, okay. More than double digit. What's the difference? The difference is tariff on import of mobile phone parts. For India, it's 12%, the MFM tariff. For Vietnam, it's just 1%. So if you want to increase your share in manufacturing, don't think about export only. Remember that whatever you need to produce to export, you also need to import the parts. If you make it difficult for producer to import the parts by imposing high tariff, you're not going to achieve your export growth, and you're not going to achieve manufacturing growth. So tariff is very critical in the objective that the secretary laid down. And if you're going to achieve them, trade, tariff are really part of the story.
Last word to you, Mr. Pandey. What is in the government's thinking? I mean, you've navigated the ship for the past few years. Which are the continuing themes and which are the new themes? Will privatization, I mean, that's in your area. Will we see more privatization? What will we expect in terms of themes of reforms from the government?
I think several things we have seen. I mean, reforms cannot be really measured in terms of just one step called privatization. We are talking of here the economic and social infrastructure. Now, kind of work which has been done by the government, both in economic and social infrastructure, look at highways, look at railways, look at ports, look at education, look at health, the kind of amount of money which has been created in institution building, the skilling, that's one part. The second thing is, you know, ease of doing business. 40,000 compliances have been removed. There are a lot more needs to be done, you know. Vivad se Vishwas tak, you know, those bills where we are really talking in terms of, you know, the laws to be changed where business can be easier. You know, this is also another set of, you know, all
ease
kinds
of doing business.
Ease of doing business. We have also to see in terms of digital DPI infrastructure. If you look at mobile telephony, if you look at internet, if you look at some of the DPI stack that India has created, the amount of productivity which is unleashed, the payment system which have been done, which have more democratized, you know, all these are a part of big, you know, elements of reforms, which together will have to be done, as I said, both on the social side as well as on the infrastructure side, together will really catapult India towards growth.
Well, I guess the agenda has been laid out very well, but we have to stick to that agenda and prove our commitment. Just because since August raised that point, I think BVR Subramaniam, the Niti Aayog CEO, referred to it. Is there a rethink on joining RCEP? RCEP, rethink on that? Because, since the point came up.
No, I think I cannot really react to what India is going to do or not going to do. A call has been taken earlier after due deliberation. I don't think that, you know, that is really the, you know, a very simple way forward. When it comes to tariffs and all that, there is a point which has been well made regarding, you know, trade policy. The trade policy and industrial policy have to work together. You know, it can't be, you know, one against another. And, you know, we, when, as I said, that we need exports and we also need imports in order to do exports. So we have to be mindful of this, and we also look at it, how much of trade is being created. If we are a part of an trading arrangements, are we really ceding territory to our trading partners, or are also we are getting benefited out of it? It depends upon the kind of complementarity that we have with our trading partners, because it could simply be. And in terms of Vietnam, Vietnam also may have its own story in terms of its, you know, physical proximity to China and a lot of Chinese investments into Vietnam in terms of that. And that is also a way of, you know, diverting the tariffs, because if the rules of origin are not very, tight, it really pay for somebody to escape very high tariffs by producing in some third countries.
Actually, Vikram, Vietnam has gained. It's called a connector country in that regard.
No, I guess the point is well taken, yeah. That we have to be worried about rules of origin, which perhaps that's why the RCEP was rethought.
Can I add that, you know, it's actually very good to know that in the latest budget, the government of India announced a number of measures to reduce tariffs,
yes,
including on mobile phones, on medical equipment, on electronics. This, as well as the fact that we're getting signals that the private sector is now ready to invest, based on the fact that the public sector has invested now and we're going to see a sort of crowding in effect. These two things, I think, are going to lead to some higher growth in manufacturing and perhaps even in export.
Okay. We are completely out of time. In fact, we've borrowed 5 minutes from the next panel. Thank you very much, Mr. Pandey, Krishna and August, for a very riveting conversation. The important part being that we have to keep our trade channels free and allow more imports and export more productivity. Thank you very much.